Okay, thank you very much. All right, we're studying the book of Zechariah. This, I think, is one of the most difficult books in God's Word to understand, or it is for me. And I'm sure I don't have all these things correct, and I'd like any help that I could get from anybody. Give me a call and give me your input to it, because I'd like to see other people's thoughts to it. And some of these things are certainly not real, real clear. Okay, we'll look at the first few chapters just in summary, right quick. All right, we know that the Zechariah and Haggai were prophets during a certain time period in Scripture, and we know that they certainly prophesied during the second. In the sixth year of Darius, who was the king of Persia, and that's when the Jews, or some of them, about 46,000 of them, had left Babylon and had come back to Jerusalem and was rebuilding Jerusalem based on the commandment given by Cyrus to go and restore and build Jerusalem, because Jerusalem had been torn down, scattered, the temple was down, and everything was tore up, so they came back. So Zechariah and Haggai were back prophesying and preaching to those people during that particular time period. Okay, and we see in chapter 1, we see, and I'll just give a real quick summary, we see that Zechariah saw a vision that had to do with a red horse rider, and behind this red horse rider were the other horses, which were red, speckled, and white. And we see later down into the chapter that we see that it talks about four horns and four carpenters that were the horns. And these represent evidently some kings and some kingdoms that had scattered the Jews And it's given to us in the past tense. It says it scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. So we're trying to figure out, well, who were those four kings and four kingdoms that scattered Israel? It's past tense, but we know Isaiah chapter 53 is written in the past tense, but we know when it was written, it was talking about Jesus Christ's crucifixion, which was in the future. So I look at these four horns, four carpenters, as being Assyria, and the carpenter there being Shalmaneser, who was the king of Assyria, who took the 10 tribes, Israel, into Assyria. The second one being Babylon, and the carpenter there being Nebuchadnezzar, he took the other two tribes, which were Judah and Benjamin, and took them into Babylon for how many years, Adam? That's right, 70 years. And so we've got two more to go. So who are they? These are people that has scattered the Jews, has scattered Israel. So I know that in 70 AD, per our calendar year, Rome came in and scattered Israel. They tore the city up, tore the temple up, and scattered the Jews all over the world. So I would say that would be one of those other horns. And most likely the carpenter would either be Titus, who is evidently the soldier that brought the army in, or it happened to be the Caesar that was ruling Rome at that time. Well, that's three. There's a fourth one. So who perchance is the fourth one? Well, I think the fourth one happens to be the king of Assyria. In the future that we see in Daniel chapter 11, verse 16, which is also under Roman rule. So in the future, we can look in Zephaniah, in other places, Daniel chapter 11, verse 16. Israel, as we see it today, is going to be demolished. It's going to be tore up. They're going to be scattered. There's not going to be hardly anything left over there. They're going to be scattered again. So to me, that's the fourth horn, fourth carpenter. That fourth carpenter would be the Antichrist. Okay. Turn to Daniel chapter 4, verse 17. These horses that we see, these red speckled and white horses, are evidently God's angels or principalities or powers that's controlling these things and is controlling these rulers that we just got through mentioned. Look in Daniel chapter 4, verse 17. And this is the talking about the vision that Nebuchadnezzar had about the tree. And we saw that God told him he was a tree. And I won't go into more discussion about it because of time. But look at verse 17. God says, "This matter is by the decree of the watchers and the demand by the word of the holy ones, to the intent that the living may know," here's what I want to get to, "that the living may know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomsoever he willeth, and setteth up over it the basis of men." So God is controlling this, and these horses here, which are God's angels most likely, are doing the controlling of who controls and the timing of all of these horns that we just got through mentioning. Okay, that's chapter 1. Chapter 2, we see that that someone comes out with a measuring line and starts to measure. And this measuring line has to do with building something, a carpenter's rule, measuring line, a plumb line. And we know that it's building Jerusalem. So the question is, when is this time when Jerusalem is being rebuilt? Is it during the time of Zechariah? Or is it during the time of the millennium? Or is it during the time of the new heavens and the new earth? When is it? And we saw here in this chapter that this Jerusalem is without walls.
You're Daniel.
No, Zechariah chapter 2. The Jerusalem that's in Zechariah chapter 2, just as a summary, is without walls. So if without walls, we looked and saw that during Zechariah's time, there was a wall. Nehemiah helped complete the walls in the gates in Jerusalem. So there were walls in the Jerusalem that Zechariah was prophesying in. So it isn't that one. We know in the new heavens and the new earth, new Jerusalem that comes down from God, in Revelation chapter 21, it talks about a great wall around the city. And it had 12 gates. So it's not that Jerusalem is talking about. So by deduction, it's the other one. It's the one during the millennium. At the end of the tribulation, Jerusalem will be devastated. The Jews will be scattered all over the world, and God will bring them back. And we know in the first 7 years of the millennium that the branch, Jesus Christ, is going to be rebuilding the temple, and the people are going to be rebuilding Jerusalem. And Zechariah chapter 2 is discussing this building of Jerusalem. That's what the measuring line is for during that period of time. And it says in Zechariah chapter 2 that Jesus Christ is going to dwell in the midst of them. And we see that same words used in Hosea chapter 6 verse 1 and 2. And that's from those verses and him dwelling with them and dwelling with them 1,000 years. That's how we get the 2 days being 2,000 years. Then we get to chapter 3. In chapter 3 we see Joshua. And this is not the Joshua that followed Moses, after Moses, that led the children of Israel into the promised land. This is Joshua, a high priest, years later. And we see that Satan is up there resisting him before the Lord. And we see that Joshua has on filthy garments. And we looked at Isaiah 64:6. It says, "All our righteousnesses are filthy rags to God," meaning nothing we can do. We can't be righteous enough to be acceptable. We have to accept Jesus Christ's righteousness in what he did on the cross for us. But it also talks about, in chapter 3, a branch is going to build the temple. And we saw that earlier. We talked about that earlier. The branch is going to build the temple, Jesus Christ, during the millennium. I turn to Proverbs 15:3. Turn to Proverbs 15:3. Proverbs 15:3 says, "The eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good." So we also saw in chapter 3 a stone that had 7 eyes. And this stone, no doubt, per Romans chapter 9, I think verse 32, is referred to Jesus Christ, the cornerstone. And these 7 eyes are, I think, is referred to as we just got looked there in Proverbs chapter 15, where God sees all the things that's going on. And so these eyes here represent his omnipresence. Okay, now let's get down to chapter 4. All right, chapter 4 is Zechariah chapter 4. Let's methodically read it and go through it. All right, Zechariah chapter 4 says, The angel that talked with me, and the angel that talked with me came again and wake me, as a man that is wakened out of his sleep. So this angel that came here, as we've seen, is most likely the angel of the Lord that we saw in Zechariah chapter 1, verse 11. And we saw in Acts chapter 27 that Paul refers to the angel of the Lord as someone, he says, whose I am and whom I serve. So this angel of the Lord, most often in the Old Testament, is talking about who, Ellen? He's talking about Jesus Christ. Verse 2. And said unto me, this angel of the Lord, which I think was Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, and said unto me, What seest thou? And I said, Zechariah said, I have looked, and behold, a candlestick, all of gold, with a bowl upon the top of it, a candlestick. All right, we know a candlestick in Scripture. We can go to Exodus chapter 25, and God gives us great detail about the candlestick. And it has on each, and I got the candlestick up here, and you see that this is, that the Jews still use this today, that on this candlestick, there's 7 points on it, 7 candles that could be put up there. And you can look, if you like, in Exodus chapter 25 to get more description of what that candlestick typically looked like. Also in Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, we see that the candlesticks represent the 7 churches of Asia that John discusses in chapter 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation. All right, let's keep on going. All right, verse 2 again. And said unto me, What seest thou? And I said, I have looked, and behold, a candlestick, all of gold, with a bowl upon the top of it, and his 7 lamps thereon, a lamp at the top of each one of these limbs, and 7 pipes to the 7 lamps which are upon the top thereof. Well, these 7 pipes evidently are pipes that supplying oil to the lamps to burn. And we'll talk about that in a little bit more detail in a moment. Verse 3. And 2 olive trees by it, one upon the right side of the bowl, and the other upon the left side thereof. So I got those crudely represented up here, the 2 olive trees beside the candlestick. Verse 4. So I answered and spoke to the angel that talked with me, saying, What are these, my Lord? answered and said unto me, Knowest thou not what these be? In other words, hey, look like you ought to know what they were. Well, I'm not sure what they were, what they are exactly. I think I know the two olive trees. And I said, No, my Lord. And I had to say, not 100% sure myself. Verse 6. Then he answered and spoke unto me, saying, This is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel. Well, now who's Zerubbabel? We know based on Haggai chapter 1, verse 1, that Zerubbabel was the governor of Judah, Joshua the high priest, during the time that they had left Babylon and came, and a few of them, a small remnant, 47, I believe, 1,000 Jews came back to Jerusalem to restore and build Jerusalem, and Zerubbabel was the governor of them, leading these people. Okay, and Zechariah and Haggai were the prophets, the preachers, preaching to the people and giving them God's word. Verse 6 says, Then he answered and spoke unto me, saying, This is the word of the Lord unto Zechariah, saying, Not by my might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. So God is saying here, it's not by your power, Zerubbabel. It's not by your power, but it's by my power that I'm giving you that these things are accomplished. Verse 7. Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. What's he talking about? Typically, the mountain in the Bible is talking about a kingdom or a king or a situation. So let's go and see what's happening at this time with Zerubbabel when he's trying to rebuild and restore Jerusalem. Go to the book of Ezra. Go to Ezra chapter 4. Ezra chapter 4, we'll see some of the difficulties that was going on at this particular time when they were trying to restore and build Jerusalem. Okay? Ezra chapter 1. Ezra chapter 4, verse 1, it says, Now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the children of the captivity builded the temple unto the Lord God of Israel, then they came to Zerubbabel and to the chief of their fathers and said unto them, Let us build with you, for we seek your God as ye do. And Zerubbabel said, No, he would not let the Gentiles help him build. If you go on down, you'll see that during this time, if you read the fourth chapter, you see at this time that there was lots and lots of adversaries and difficulties on the Jews. It was trying to rebuild the temple and rebuild Jerusalem to the point that they'd have a trowel in one hand and a spear, a bow and arrow, in the other hand to protect themselves. And if you go to verse, if I can find it right quick, it's Syria that was giving them the difficulty. And I can't find the word, and it's somewhere in there. That Syria was giving them the difficulty and the problem. Let's go back to Zechariah chapter 4. So Zechariah chapter 4, verse 7, when it says, Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. It appears to me that he's talking about Syria. Syria is going to not be successful in stopping Israel, Judah, and Benjamin from rebuilding Jerusalem and building the temple. All right, let's continue. And he shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shouting, crying, Grace, grace unto it. The headstone to the temple. Go here and go to Romans chapter 9. In Romans chapter 9, of course we know who the headstone ultimately represents. It represents Jesus Christ. Go to Romans chapter 9, verse 32, which says, wherefore, let's go to verse 31. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, and remember what Isaiah 64:6 says, that it can't be our righteousness. It's Jesus Christ's righteousness, or faith in Him, or faith in what God told us to do, or what He told Israel to do. Verse 31, but Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, have not attained to the law of righteousness. Wherefore, because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law. They just did the works of the law ceremoniously and not by faith. Their heart was not in it. For they stumbled at the stumbling stone. They stumbled at the truth. They stumbled at God's word. They stumbled at God's word. And in John chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. It's God's Word. That's how He communicates with you and I today. And we have it in the King James Bible. It's His preserved Word. Verse 33. For it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on Him shall not be ashamed. Now back to Zechariah chapter 4. Verse 10. For who hath despised the day of small things? For they shall rejoice in the earth and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel with those seven. And they are the eyes of the Lord, which run to and fro through the whole earth. And we read in Proverbs chapter 15 a while ago, that's God knowing all good and evil, and He knows all things. He sees all of that. Okay? You might would have thought about Isaiah chapter 11. It talks about the seven attributes of the Holy Spirit of God. But here I think Proverbs 15 is a better match for interpreting this verse. All right, now verse 11 of Zechariah chapter 4. Then answered I and said unto him, what are these two olive trees upon the right side of the candlestick and upon the left side thereof? So we're going back to the candlesticks in the earlier part of the chapter. And I answered again and said unto him, what be these two olive branches which through the two golden pipes empty the golden oil out of themselves? So these two olive trees are supplying oil to these lamps. So what may that be referring to? Go to Revelation chapter 11. Revelation chapter 11. Revelation chapter 11, verse 3. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. And these are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. And they prophesied, as you saw in verse 3, they prophesied. So this oil emptying out of themselves, this golden oil, is words. It's God's word. They are preaching God's word. Verse 13 of Zechariah 4. And he answered and said, knowest thou not what these be? And I said, no, my Lord. He didn't know. He didn't understand. Then said he, these are the two anointed ones that stand by the Lord of the whole earth. So it's not too difficult, I don't think, to figure out who these two olive trees are.
Others than Elijah.
That's correct. So So go to Matthew chapter 17. Linda said Moses and Elijah. Go to Matthew chapter 17. We won't read it, but we'll just look at it. Matthew chapter 17 talks about the transfiguration of Jesus Christ. And let's go to verse 1. Matthew chapter 17, verse 1 says, "And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John," and I think these are the three that wrote at least James, John, and 1 John in the book of Revelation, these three people. "And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun." And we had a class on the light and sun, how powerful that is. "And his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto him Moses and Elijah talking with him, and they were beside Jesus Christ." Go to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Who are these two anointed ones? Acts chapter 1, verse 9. Acts chapter 1, verse 9. "And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a great cloud covered him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, stood by the people watching, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go up." And those two folks, no doubt, was Moses and Elijah. Now, in Jude chapter 1, verse 9, it says that Satan contended with Michael, I believe it was Michael, contended with Michael about the body of Moses. Moses died. No one could find his body. And evidently, God took his body off to earth and resurrected Moses. Elijah, in 2 Kings chapter 2, we see that Elijah was physically taken off to earth. He did not die. He went up in a whirlwind into heaven. Okay? All right, now turn to Revelation chapter 11 again. So these two olive trees, Revelation chapter 11, verse 3 again, and also, that's the wrong place. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days in sackcloth. And these are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in the same manner be killed. And if you go on down reading here, what happens to these two witnesses? The same miracles that Moses and Elijah conducted in the Old Testament, these two witnesses, two candlesticks, two olive trees, did the same kind of thing. Turned water into blood. They didn't let it rain for 3.5 years. The same kind of activities. Okay? We also know that in, turn to Malachi. We're going back to Zechariah. In Malachi chapter 3, look at Malachi chapter 3. We know that Elijah must come first and restore all things before Jesus Christ comes back. So obvious to me, but let's look at Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come in his temple, even the messenger of the covenant. All right, and you also note in Matthew chapter 11, about verse 10, that Jesus Christ said, if you will accept this, then John the Baptist is Elijah. But they didn't accept it. So, based on foreknowledge, then John the Baptist was not Elijah, but he could have been. He would do the same things that Elijah would do when Elijah comes back in Revelation chapter 11. Now back to Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 14. And he said, these are the two anointed ones that stand by the Lord of the whole earth. Okay, now chapter 5. In chapter 5, let's read it. Then I turned and lift up my eyes, and behold, and looked, and behold, a flying roll. And he said unto me, what seest thou? And I answered, I see a flying roll. The length thereof is 20 cubits, and the breadth thereof is 10 cubits. And a cubit is about a foot and a half, so this roll would be about 15 feet by about 30 feet. Pretty good sized roll. Then said he unto me, this is the curse that goeth forth over the face of the whole earth. And I'm going to pause here, and I'm going to tell you what I think this roll is, and then we'll continue to read, and we'll see if that's a possibility. I'm not real sure. I have an idea. I think this roll here, let's go to Psalms chapter 12. What is this roll? Psalms chapter 12, God doesn't tell us. But that's the reason why he said, study to show thyself approved unto God, a work that need not be ashamed, rightly divided, the words are studied. You don't get these things except by studying and looking at it in prayer. And even with all that, God may not reveal certain things. It may not be time. God told Daniel in Daniel chapter 12, he says, go thy way, Daniel, and I can't quote it, and close the book or something. Let's turn to Daniel. Turn to Daniel. Can't quite get it. Turn to Daniel chapter 12. Now, I know there's some people listening to this right now. They say, Plant Man, you've said that so many times. You're orthodox. I know what it is. All right. Go thy way, Daniel, for their words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. So there's some things that God reveals at certain times, and there's some things God doesn't reveal until later, or until after you've studied and worked at it. All right, back to Psalms chapter 12, verse 6. It says, the words of the Lord are pure words as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. God's words are preserved. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. God communicates to us through his word. His word is pure. John 1 says, in the beginning was the word. God is the word. Holy men spake of God as they were moved by the Holy Spirit of God to communicate to us. He preserved his word. So we have it in the King James Bible. So my thinking of what this roll is here in Zechariah, back to Zechariah chapter 5, this flying roll is other so-called books that claim to be God's word, and they aren't. Because God said he's going to preserve it, so he preserved it. So it's the King James Bible I'm absolutely convinced of, because of many, 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 many different things you will not get out of other so-called Bibles, because they're taken out, they're changed, you can't get them. So you can't get the understanding, you can't get prophecy, you can't get salvation, you can't get rightly dividing, you can't get the difference between Peter and Paul out of these other books. They are cursed. this roll here appears to be a scroll of other corrupt Bibles, not God's preserved word, one of them being the NIV. So as we read down through here, think about what's in here and see if that will match. Back to verse 1 of chapter 5. Then I turned and lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a flying roll. And he said unto me, What seest thou? And I answered, I see a flying roll. The length thereof is 20 cubits, and the breadth thereof is 10 cubits. Then said he unto me, This is the curse that goeth forth over the face of the whole earth. For everyone that stealeth shall be cut off, as one on this side according to it, and everyone that sweareth shall be cut off as on that side according to it. I'll bring it forth, saith the Lord of hosts, and it shall enter into the house of the thief, and into the house of him that sweareth falsely by my name. That comes to be important. Sweareth falsely by my name. We're going to come back to these. And it shall remain in the midst of his house, and shall consume it with the timber thereof and the stones thereof. So I say, yep, I think that'll match. I think that's talking about God's corrupt word, God's word being corrupted. It's in people's houses, and it fills their houses and people, and fills the churches and all, and they don't get the truth. You cannot get the truth of the different gospels given to Peter and the gospel given to Paul. You can't find that truth in any book except God's preserved word, the King James Bible. Go to Galatians chapter 2, verse 7. It's just one place to look and see it. You can't get prophecies straightened out because of Daniel chapter 9, verse 26. These other so-called books, Satan adds a word. The word is the, which we've looked at many times. That one word being added, the word T-H-E, messes up the interpretation of Daniel's 70 weeks. It messes up prophecy big time. One little word. So God preserved his word. This roll or scroll is a curse. It gets into humanity, and it's corrupted them, and it messes them up. All right, this stealeth. Stealing is robbery. Go to John chapter 10.
Go to Galatians 2 yet.
Go to John chapter 10. Verse 1 and 2. John chapter 10, verse 1 and 2. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth in not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. He's a stealer. He's not doing it correctly. We know in Romans chapter 11, verse 13, Paul says, I am the apostle to the Gentiles. It's a thief and a robber. He stealeth. When the NIV says differently, that Paul did not have a different gospel. It's a thievery. Sweareth. Sweareth falsely by my name, it says in Zechariah. Turn to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. Excuse me, I'm kind of slow. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, it says, Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, 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 shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in my name doth many wondrous works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work in iniquities. So swear falsely by his name. So I think that's what Zechariah chapter 5 is talking about. We know in, we will turn there, in Revelation chapter 13, verse 5, that the Antichrist blasphemes. He swears falsely. Okay? All right, let's go back to Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. Zechariah 5:5. Then the angel that talked with me went forth and said to me, lift up now thy eyes and see what is this that goeth forth. And I said, what is it? So he still didn't see it, understand. And he said, this is an ephod that goeth forth. He said, moreover, this is their remembrance through all the earth.
Resemblance.
So that an ephod is a basket, like a bushel basket. It's a basket that you can put things in. Verse 7. And behold, there was lifted up a talent of lead, in other words, a certain weight of lead. And this is a woman that sitteth in the midst of the ephod. There's a woman in that basket. And he said, this is wickedness. There's something about this is wickedness. And he cast it into the midst of the ephod, and he cast the weight of lead upon the mouth thereof. In other words, this woman in this basket, and he puts a lead covering over the top of it. Then lifted up my eyes and looked, and beheld, there came out two women. And the wind was in their wings. In their wings. So these women here are not angels. Angels don't have wings. Now whether or not these women really had wings or not, I say, well, I guess they did. It represents something. They're not angels. For they had wings like the wings of a stork. And they lifted up the ephod between the earth and heaven. They took this basket and he took it up into the sky. Then said I to the angel that talked with me, whither do these bear the ephod? And he said unto me, to build it, a house in the land of Shinar, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base. Pray tell, what's this talking about? Okay, here's a thought. Shinar is the place, if we were to go to Genesis chapter 11, Shinar is the place where the Tower of Babel was constructed, where God confounded the people's languages and separated them. This is where great evil came to a climax, and God separated them. They were trying to build a tower up into the heavens. It was great wickedness at Shinar. And that's the reason why I think Shinar comes up here. This was where great wickedness occurred. Right, this woman, I think, go to Revelation chapter 17. In Revelation chapter 17, we know who Jezebel is. She was the wife of Ahab, and she was a very wicked queen, and she did great wickedness and great things against God. All right, we know that God uses this here, the woman, to represent some wickedness. Go to Revelation chapter 17. That's a great chapter to study and understand. We'll read just a couple of verses out of it. Verse 1, and there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials. What's the seven vials? The wrath of God. Not the wrath of the Lamb. They're different, aren't they? The wrath of the Lamb is the trumpets. And talked with me, saying unto me, come thither. I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore, that sitteth upon many waters. Okay, and you go on down reading here the chapter. In this chapter, it talks about the great wickedness. It talks about a mystery Babylon. And it talks about, evidently, principally, the Catholic Church. The great horrible doctrine that's in there and how that was spread. And people were killed. And horrible stuff about that. About this woman, this great whore, as God represents to her. And the reason he calls it a whore, because they went against God's judgment, went against God's commandments, went against God himself, and went after other gods. And when they do that, God refers to that as adultery. Okay? So this great wickedness, this woman in this basket in Zechariah, I think is referring to that woman. Okay, we also see in Jeremiah chapter 44, we see that this woman is referred to as the Queen of Heaven. In Judges chapter 2, her name is given, Ashtaroth, or the Queen of Heaven. So there's a religion that worships the Queen of Heaven. It's out there, these false religions that are worshiping everything else but God. So I think that's what this great wickedness is here talking about. Okay, so it's this great wickedness, and it's put in a basket, and this basket's taken up into the heavens, and a city is going to be built. Alright, so we know that Satan does everything he can to copycat truth. He comes as an angel of light, but he's in sheep's clothing. He's really a raging wolf. It's not correct. So we turn to John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, we see that there's a city being built now for someone, and it's not this city, is it? But this is the true city. Look in John chapter 14, verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. We know in the book of Revelation, go over to Revelation chapter 21. What's that city called? What's that city called that has as many mansions in it? Go to Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. After the millennium, after God redoes the heaven and the earth with fire, then we get to Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. And it says, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. You turn to 2 Peter, about chapter, at the end of 2 Peter, you'll get more description of that. Verse 2. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Now back to Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 5, verse 11. And he said to me, to build it an house in the land of Shinar, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base. Now, I don't understand what all that means, but evidently, this wickedness, this great whore, is trying to mimic New Jerusalem building. Exactly how that's carried out, I'm not sure, but I know it'll be destroyed. So this woman, no doubt in my mind, is talking about going against God, other gods, worshiping other gods, and that God may be yourself or your own activities. So I think that's what that's talking about. All right, so that's Zechariah chapter 4 and chapter 5. And next time we pick up chapter 6 and 7, maybe continue. Okay? All right, thank you.